Hello, welcome to Connie Martinson Talks Books. People often ask me, what have you read lately and what would you recommend? Well, the book we're going to be talking about today is number one on my list. It is Lisa C's Dreams of Joy, published by Random House. Welcome, Lisa.
Thanks for having me again.
Listen, thank you for writing this book. I couldn't put it down. And what's interesting, it's not a fast, easy read.
No. Well, parts of it are, I think.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, parts of it, you get to a part where it's like, oh my gosh, I've got to find out what's going to happen next.
Yeah, but there's also, you almost like music, you swell and I go with it, but I'm thinking as I'm reading and I'm enjoying every minute. So anybody who has read Shanghai Girls, this is a sequel.
Right, but you don't have to have read that to read this book, because there is that little three-page synopsis right at the beginning that gets you right into the story. And even if you read Shanghai Girls a couple of years ago and you forgot what it was about, that three-page synopsis is right there in the beginning, and it kind of catches you up. At that moment, a 19-year-old girl has just found out that the woman she thought was her mother is not her mother, the woman she thought was her father is not her father, and the woman she thought was her aunt is not her aunt, is actually her mother. And off she runs away to China. It's 1957.
And she has gone to the University of Chicago.
Right.
Gotten involved with the Chinese students who are there, who are all pro-Mao. You know, let's get rid of the Mandarin's time.
Well, they're a little bit of that. But, you know, actually what they were really looking for, the Chinese Students Democratic League, which, and there were branches all around the country, was sort of equal rights and social issues, so that they were out picketing for integration at the Woolworths lunch counter, that sort of thing. So they were, it was not just pro Mao. It was really looking at civil rights around the world, but also in this country.
What I loved was when she starts to run away and she calls one of her boyfriends from that group, and he says, listen, I'm going to law school. I mean, you know, that was okay in college, but what do you mean giving everything up and go?
Right, yes, and she thought he was with her 100%, and he's the first of many disappointments she's going to experience.
And part of the disappointment is also in the beginning when her father, whom she thinks is her father, it kills himself because the FBI was coming after him.
That's right. There was something in 1957, the confession program here, which was a U.S. government program that had targeted Chinese who had come here illegally as paper sons, and in an effort to sort of save his daughter and save his family, he commits suicide, because once he's out of the picture, they have no way of going after his family. Mm-hmm. And Joy feels tremendous guilt for this. Rightly or wrongly, she feels tremendous guilt about
it. Had you known people who were paper sons?
Well, we had some in our own family, in my own family. You know, I am part Chinese, so yes, I knew people who were and are still paper sons. I also interviewed people who had been targeted or during the confession program or had stepped forward voluntarily. And I remember this one man that I interviewed in his 80s now, and he told me his whole story. And at the end, he said, you know, we have never told our children, we've never told our grandchildren what happened back then, because we aren't dead yet, so we aren't safe yet.
One hates to think of that going on in this country, but it does. Mm-hmm. She gets over to Hong Kong and then gets into China.
Right.
In China, she meets, finally gets to see her real father, C.G. C.G., who had had an affair with both her mother and her aunt.
Mm-hmm. Yep, he did. he didn't get too far with Pearl, but he obviously had an affair with May, and all of a sudden he has this daughter that he had not known existed show up on his front step.
And he's in trouble with the government.
Mm-hmm. He is, but Joy is so naive that she doesn't understand really what she's seeing or even what he's saying. Yeah. And so they go out together to the Chinese countryside to teach peasants art. And they actually stay in this 17th century villa that's modeled on a house that I stayed in China.
At that point, he's going to, a thousand butterflies, but this is let everybody have an art and portray the Chinese world. Mm-hmm. And not everybody is made to be an artist.
No, not everyone is made to be an artist, and also for Ziji, and I think this is true for true artists,
yeah,
that there's this old saying, art is the heartbeat of the artist. And so the government may tell you what you can paint and may tell you what your subjects can be, but if you are a true artist, you can't escape your essential nature. And so there's always going to be things that you're painting or creating that the government might not like.
Yeah. Which brings them to an award, and Ziji gets an award.
Mm-hmm. And he's kind of redeemed. He's temporarily redeemed.
And including, they're invited, she is included with him to dinner with Chairman Mao.
Mm-hmm.
Now that would be, that's bigger than meeting the president.
Well, in China, I think it was at that time. And he was actually a very fun character to write, you know, because there's been so much written about him, and so much of it now is revisionist. And it's hard to remember that there was this time when he could be sort of charming and flirtatious. Well, we know he was flirtatious, but that he could be charming and interesting even. This was really before that government became so immensely corrupt, I guess, is
was
the only way to phrase it.
After the Gang of Four?
Before.
Before it.
Before. And one of the things that's interesting is this, so this is set during the what was called the Great Leap Forward.
Yeah.
And there are many scholars today who believe that the Cultural Revolution never would have happened if the Great Leap Forward hadn't occurred and had been such a disaster. And so this was a way, launching the Great Leap Forward was a way of diverting attention from the failures of the Great Leap Forward. Mm-hmm. And, you know, there have been so many novels written about the Great Leap Forward and memoirs written about the Great Leap Forward, and hardly anything, almost nothing about novels written about the Cultural Revolution and memoirs about the Cultural Revolution, but almost nothing about the Great Leap Forward.
Because I was astounded how in this little canton of, pronounce the name for me, that they're at, they have to double their
output
for the government.
Right, yes, the farmers were required to produce this vast amount more of agricultural produce, but also steel. So people had to strip down every piece of metal that they could find in their homes, in their schools, where they worked, and melt it in what were called backyard furnaces.
What's interesting, too, is that she goes back to this little canton with Ziji and her mother, who has arrived in town, and her mother just wants to bring her back to America.
Right, just that's her main goal, is how are they going to get home?
But little Joy has fallen in love.
Mm-hmm.
And she meets Tao, they get married, and the next day she would have done anything in the world.
To go home.
To go home.
That's right.
Yeah.
Well, you know, one of the interesting things for me writing Joy is she is young, she's impetuous, she's stubborn, she's idealistic, and I don't know how you were at that age, but you know at that, I know I made some mistakes.
Yeah.
And so, you
my
know,
friend Lisa made mistakes, never. Yeah.
But you know, I did. Yeah. And so, you know, how do you then overcome those things that you do when you're young?
Yeah.
And sometimes, and she has a very difficult time, you know, it's not an easy path for her after she makes several mistakes. And then the rest of the novel is, how is she going to get out of it, really?
Yeah, because she's got a mother-in-law. There are 12 of them living in two rooms.
Two rooms, right. Well, this is very poor. This is true life as it was in the Chinese countryside in a small village if you were very, very poor in the 1950s.
Meanwhile, her mother, Pearl, is in the big city, and you needed permission
to travel. Mm-hmm. Yes, you needed permission to travel, you needed coupons to live, to buy all of your food, to buy thread, to buy anything. And, you know, Pearl, she grew up in Shanghai and then immigrated here to Los Angeles. Yeah. And by now, you know, Los Angeles is her true home, and yet she still has her childhood home in Shanghai.
Which I loved that she went there and her bedroom was the way she had left it.
Yes, and that was something that when I did research, you know, I kept seeing this or hearing about this, that people would leave and when they would come back 20, 30, 40, 50 years later, the house would be exactly the same, the room would be exactly the same. They would have left the glass on the table just as the day they left. And there's this idea in Chinese culture that the fallen leaf always returns to the root. And so there's always this belief that even if you travel away, even if you go far, far away, you will always return. And so you can see that in small villages all across the country, and across the country in China. In fact, even when I went back to my home village in China, you could see these traces of my great-grandparents. And my great-grandmother was a Caucasian woman. Yeah. And they still referred to the house as the Lofan. You know, it was the house that belonged, the white ghost house.
Yeah.
All these years later.
Speaking of going back, there is the cruelest scene. Well, one of the cruelest scenes, I must say, you had it really right from blood at that time, when the woman who has her feet bound.
Oh, yes.
Yeah, tell our friends.
Yes, so one of the things when Mao took power was that he wanted all the women who had had their feet bound to unwrap them. And this was a very painful process. These were women who'd had their feet reduced down to about the size of their thumb and wrapped up for all these years. And in some places, they did it properly. It was a long course where you would do it very slowly, but nevertheless, terribly, terribly painful. But in this, in Dreams of Joy, there is a struggle session against an old woman who used to be one of the landlord's wives. And what happens to her as they unwrap her feet in this very fast way and make her walk, and what happens to her is just tragic.
Oh, and she's left, she can only crawl.
Right, she can only crawl. Yeah. Because these bones, you know, once they're broken to make bound feet, they're never going to heal properly. They're just broken forever. And so there's, once they're unwrapped, there's nothing holding your foot together.
Yeah, terrible. Tragic. And then with Pearl in Shanghai, the friend of her mother's also has the bound feet because her mother had had them.
Right, Madame Hu. And you know, I loved writing her because there was that idea again of you've come back after all these years and here are still people from the past. They haven't gone anywhere. They're still there. And I, you know, in many ways, I think this book is about mothers and daughters and mother love. Mm-hmm. And so, of course, there's Pearl and her daughter, Joy, and later there's Joy and her daughter, Samantha. But also, Madame Hu sort of serves as a mother to Pearl, as, you know, now that Pearl's mother is gone. And her journey, I think, Madame Hu's journey, and how she is living in this new communist country, still has all of her servants, still is dressed beautifully, still has her beautiful house. And one of the things I was trying to do was to show that even though this country had changed in 1949, it was not overnight. One of the things that Mao, or the government, wanted was for anybody who had had servants, chauffeurs, cooks, maids, butlers, to keep them, you know, that you had to keep them so there wouldn't be mass unemployment. So there were some people who were living just as they had all along. They just shut their drapes so that they could do it behind curtains.
Now, was that based on reason?